Nearly everyone likes the Alfa Romeo Montreal, and it's easy to see why. But if you've ever wondered why there's an Alfa named after a Canadian city more than 6,000 kilometers away from Milan, you're about to get your answer. Our story begins with the inauguration of the 1967 World's Fair in Montreal. The visitors of the pavilion dedicated to mankind's technical achievements were treated to the sight of two identical Alfa Romeo coupés, resplendent in pearlescent white paint. It is unclear why the expo's organizers chose Alfa Romeo, but it does make sense once you consider the brief was to express nothing less than the highest aspiration of man in terms of automobiles. Pulling it off wasn't easy though, as the expo's organizers approached Alfa Romeo just 9 months before the event's inauguration. The dauntingly short time frame led the company to choose the existing Giulia GT's platform as a starting point and outsource the task of designing and constructing the two prototypes to Nuccio Bertone's famed Carrozzeria, as creating heart-stopping show cars within impossible deadlines was his firm's specialty. Bertone's designer Marcello Gandini had just finished working on the Lamborghini Miura, and its design language was a clear influence on the Alfa prototypes, despite the different technical configurations. As the car's intended purpose was simply to wow the expo's visitors, Gandini dug deep into its bag of tricks, concealing the headlights behind slots in a giant clamshell bonnet and adding non-functional side slots. The latter was a design element borrowed from a previous Bertone prototype, the Kangoo from 1964. The result was a sleek vision for the future that promised speed way beyond what the installed power plant could provide, as both show cars were equipped with the base Giulia TI 1.6L twin-cam engine. While that was already more than enough for sitting on a turntable, it was clear to everyone at Alfa Romeo that an eventual production model needed a powertrain just as exotic as Bertone's bold exterior design. Luckily, Alfa Romeo's racing arm AutoDelta had just the right engine, in the form of the 2L 4-cam V8 used on the Tipo 33 Sports Prototype Racers and the Low Production 33 Stradale. In short, the Montreal project became a production reality thanks to a unique set of circumstances: the contemporary availability of the stunning Bertone prototype and AutoDelta's racing V8 engine during a period of growth and confidence for Alfa Romeo as a whole. That doesn't mean the transition from show to production car was devoid of challenges, though. AutoDelta's V8 made plenty of power, but it was a screamer designed with racing in mind. Transforming it into the smooth, flexible power plant Montreal owners know and love was a laborious re-engineering process. The remarkably compact aluminum engine block remained very similar to the one used on the 33 Sports prototypes, but its displacement grew to roughly 2.6 liters thanks to a 2mm wider bore and a 12.3 mm longer stroke. The new crankshaft abandoned the 33's flat plane design for more traditional 90 degrees cross plane to achieve a better balance. However, the engine block's design limited the size of the more substantial counterweights the new crankshaft needed, forcing Alfa Romeo to source an aerospace-grade sintered tungsten alloy because of its high specific weight. To keep the bonnet line as low as possible, the Montreal's V8 retained the dry sump lubrication system used on the 33s, a solution typical of racing engines but rarely used on production ones due to its additional costs. The Lucas Indirect Fuel Injection System used on the 33 racing engines was replaced for the Montreal by a system developed by the Alfa Romeo subsidiary Spica, similar to the one used on the US spec Spiders and GTs. The result was a remarkably compact and lightweight power plant rated at 200 horsepower at 6500 rpm, that, most importantly, produced already 90% of its maximum torque output at just 2700 rpm. Perhaps the least inspiring aspect of the Montreal is its chassis design, that, due to costs and time constraints, remained a close derivative of the 1750 GTV, albeit with a 2mm wider track at the front and 12 at the rear. The body shell of the Montreal was manufactured by Bertone Near Turin, starting from the floor pan and firewall pressings supplied by Alfa's Arese plant, where the bodies were sent back once fully completed to receive their engines and running gear. Even though the Montreal nowadays gets almost universal admiration wherever it goes, contemporary critics were somewhat less impressed with it when it went on sale in early 1971. Compared to the prototype from nearly 4 years earlier, the production car appeared chunkier and less streamlined due to the many modifications made to make more room in the cabin and under the bonnet. Despite the V8's remarkably compact dimensions, the bonnet line and scuttle still had to become taller, and so did the roofline. The windshield sat at a less aggressive angle, and the curvature of the side windows was reduced, while the front overhang was nearly 6 cm shorter than the original prototype. On top of that, what was considered the cutting edge of automotive design was moving on rapidly at the time, and the Montreal's curves seemed almost old-fashioned against the sharp wedge designs that Bertone itself was pioneering at the time. Nevertheless, initial enthusiasm for Alfa's new flagship GT proved high. 668 cars were delivered in 1971, which became 2,377 the following year. An excellent result given the model's steep retail price and high running costs. However, it was going to be all downhill from here, as the oil crisis triggered by the Yom Kippur War decimated the performance car market between 1973 and 74. Conceived in a period of prosperity and optimism, the Montreal was decidedly out of place in the new era of high fuel costs, speed limits on motorways, and double-digit inflation. Montreal production fell to a trickle, but the model remained on Alfa's catalog until as late as 1977, when just 27 cars were completed.